thing about the budget is, it's been already a month, so most of us are now forgetting what the budget was about. But the one thing that comes to your mind when you think about the budget, and this happened when I moved back to India about 10 years back, why is it that India does such a, this brouhaha, why is it such a big deal? We don't discuss budget in most modern economies. And the answer is simply that that's because in very few countries, the government still is such an active player in almost every sector. So it's very important to understand what the, you know, financial plans, which is what the budget is meant to be, is of the government for different sectors. Because then private, you know, institutions, individuals, firms, everyone then optimizes based on the signals that the government gives out. That's why we'd like to listen to the budget and try and analyze what the lessons are. We're reading a bit of the tea leaves when you listen to a finance minister speak, but it's an important exercise in India. Okay. The other thing that struck me is that Indian budget, the minute analysis starts by so-called experts in this country, then you start tracking the stock market. The stock market, you're trying now, you know, in market microstructure, which is an area of finance research, there you try and track high frequency trade and you try and see if there is an announcement effect. And that's what they're basically trying to figure out through the budget, what is the announcement effect of certain announcements? Does the Sensex really reflect any sentiments against the announcement? Except that, you know, the stock market is such a small component of the financial sector. And the financial sector in India, because we are financially a repressed economy, the financial sector is still a very small part of the economy as a whole. And the budget is really meant for the economy. So, you know, this time, for instance, they tried reading, oh, it's looking good, and then it's like, so there was a lot of yo-yo in the market, and experts are trying to read sense into it. But the point is, you can't. This was a little bit like the Bihar elections. BJP has done really well. And then 10 minutes later, they're giggling. No, they haven't done well. So all of you in this room, read, okay? Don't just listen to experts. And read research. I implore you, because you have young sponge-like minds. You're also at this phase when you shouldn't get carried away by what you hear on TV. You should really go out and read some of them, particularly folks who are from this institution. You have to create a culture of reading research, because you don't see research in popular media in India as much as you should. Now let me move to the budget itself. My expectations from the budget were so low that I was actually very happy with this budget. And partly that was because, you know, the first budget of this government was like a zero budget. And then later when I was speaking to many embassy people who had come to do a briefing at Brookings, I mean, the way I analyzed it for them was, you know, the government has changed, but the entire government machinery is the same as before. So the people preparing the books, the details, are the same people, the same bureaucrats who have the institutional know-how, which is why they're very important, they were the same as before. So just the change of head or the change of the political leadership doesn't get immediately reflected in a new budget. Though I do believe the BJP should have done their homework. They have been out of power for 10 years. When you're out of power, you don't just, you stay out of power. You actually, it's a professional, it's a job. So you're meant to prepare what your economic, you know, viewpoint should be, and you prepare blueprints accordingly. So I think they were a bit caught unaware. So the first budget, nothing happened. The second budget, and finally it was this budget where we saw, despite what you might hear, my take is I was happy with it. Not because you had the big bang reforms, which I think if Modi had wanted in the first year, he could have asked for the moon and he would have got it. He could have asked for administrative reform and we would have seen heads rolling and, you know, incentive compatibility contract come in. A lot of things that as efficiency enhancing mechanisms that all, you know, students of economics will understand, the economy and the larger society would have probably given it to him on a platter, because he had come in with this overwhelming majority and the opposition was very meek then. So he could have done all those things, but Delhi is different from Gujarat. Delhi is a much bigger beast. There are so many other things happening. It takes everyone time, and that's my reading, that it has taken this government some time to figure out how to go about these things. Now, what I liked in this, again, are not the big budget, but the big bang reforms or the gradual reforms. And that's why I wrote a piece, I think it came out in the Mint, I call it the Marginal Revolution Budget. Okay? The reason I call it a Marginal Revolution Budget is because when you say structural reform, you know, you hear this all the time in the newspaper, but what exactly does it mean? What is structural reform? Structural reform is about setting in place certain institutions, certain rules, which can then free up the markets in a way, or it can enhance efficiency. Things can work at a faster pace, lower cost, so on and so forth. So one which I was very impressed by, finally, the recognition, the legal status given to Aadhaar. So I was very happy with this, because for, you know, it's a place instrument only if you recognize what the potential of the instrument is. It isn't just meant for biometrics the way it has been so far sold. It can be a very powerful instrument or an institution to enhance economies of scale and scope in this country across the mainstream markets. It's not just about BPL families, okay? It's not just about financial inclusion drives to people. It can be about, you know, everybody. It can be the regular mainstream segments of the economy where this can be one of, you know, that unifying platform where these transactions can be carried out in very. Then, you know, little things like the, which are not so little, the LPG connection for BPL households. It was one of those, these are all side notes, by the way. These were not the big budget things. But do you know indoor pollution is one of the biggest killers in this country? There's no odd even for indoor pollution. Okay, that's number one. Number two, it disproportionately affects rural economy, right? The rural segment. Third, it disproportionately affects women and children in the household. And that is why it has never achieved or attained the kind of importance in policy which it, you know, the research has been showing for a very long time now. Now, if this government can actually extend LPG connection to 50 million poor households, we are talking about a huge gain in terms of health outcomes. Okay? And that has gone unnoticed. In fact, many people said, well, there's nothing on gender in this budget. I think that's a very, very big gender issue. Then there's a little bit on, you know, the Stand Up India and why women will be given. And I, for those of you who believe I'm a feminist, all of you are feminists who have some amount of education. Okay, you believe in equal rights. But, you know, markets break down when it comes to these kind of social things. Because markets are not meant to distinguish between a male and a female. You give the job, you give the contract to whoever is the best performing. But because women have traditionally not had equal opportunity, I will pick up the guy who's the least transaction cost to me, the person whom I see most likely male. So India is the only country where labor force participation of women is declining with growth. How bizarre is that? And that is an enigma. We have had some amounts of research, but not enough to conclusively show what is leading to this. Why are women actually dropping out of the labor force? And some of it is accounted for the fact that women are actually now staying in schools longer. So they're getting higher education. But that's not enough to showcase actually the decline. So there's something else happening. So this is where, and certain amounts of, you know, your gut logic, some amount of scanning, cursory scan of the data will tell you that job markets are not equal opportunity. Okay? And the reason they're not equal opportunity is because we do not have maternity leave policy, we do not have childcare institutions, and these are all different kind of facilitating mechanisms which makes, you know, equal opportunity labor market for men and women. And when you don't have these institutions, the cost is much higher on the woman. So women do tend to drop out if the work environment isn't conducive to them working despite higher education, training and so on. Okay? So any policy which is socially driven towards women should be lauded in this country. Primarily again because we start off on a very bad footing. Now in terms of health and education, because, well, while this budget did mention quite a few things about, you know, infrastructure, that too, particularly rural infrastructure, the investments are massive. And these are great things. And the reason it is because you have, for those of you who have had a chance to look at the growth numbers, you know, your industrial production is coming down, your exports are coming down. If you look at all these metrics individually, it tells you where is this 7% coming from? Right? That is one of the mysteries. And the mystery actually can be understood if you see the government spending. The growth is largely coming from public spending. And what is the government spending on? These kind of investments. So these are excellent. These are exactly the kind of stuff that a government should do, primarily when its revenue are rising, largely because of oil prices declining. So when they're left with reserve, these are the kind of investments you want. Okay, so that is growing. Now, in the rural area, it is required because we do have a rural distress. You know, the agriculture sector has been facing certain amount of distress now for the second year in running. Okay. And in fact, many claim that, you know, when the farmer rally was held by the Congress and so on, people showed up not because they were supportive of Congress. They said, what's going to happen to our crops? So there were legitimate concerns in the farm community, which was meant. And in response to that, you saw one of the largest announcements in terms of the schemes of crop insurance. Now, it's a good scheme to have. But let me also tell you that some of my own research has shown that crop insurance has failed almost everywhere. And you know why? Because the, and for those of you again who have studied some amount of insurance, you will know that the risks are very high. The measurement error in terms of what is exactly the loss of the crop is very difficult to measure. Okay? And that's the reason why even in economies which are financially, by the way, very advanced, Japan, US, the cost of crop insurance is a multiple of the actual revenue, the premium. So it tells you that financially it is not a very sustainable product. Now, what should you do? These kind of products should typically be tied with some kind of weather metric, somewhere where the measurement can be simpler. So rainfall insurance, because it is easy to measure rainfall, weather conditions like heat, some amount of humidity, these are all things that can be easily measured. Okay, so there is now a pushback in terms of the crop insurance that it's good that you've announced, but now make the instrument a little more sophisticated so that it can actually become sustainable in the long run.
Let me take a cue from Shamika and talk to you a little bit about first this whole budget exercise. Why is it such a big deal? I must confess again that she kind of finished me off by saying, don't listen to these so-called experts. I am one of those. So because I've been speaking on the budget for about 15, 20 years now. And, you know, it's very predictable. And we were having this conversation just now where I was telling these chaps that what happens in a typical budget exercise, and this is going on for the last 20 years that I have been doing this. Earlier, Shamika, you weren't around at that time, but earlier they used to lock us up. Right? So what happened was that the only place where you would comment on the budget was Doordarshan. So they took a bunch of us, put us into one room and locked us up. And gave us the budget document. So you were, you know, you're sewn to secrecy. Anyway, there were no cell phones and stuff, so you couldn't transfer any information out. The reason was that this budget in India was supposed to be about surprises. That suddenly on the 29th or 28th of March, the government would catch you by surprise by giving an extra tax on cashew nuts. Right? For example, this is a real story. Actually, 1 year I saw cashew nut tariff going up by 60%. Nobody could still tell me why. Why cashew nuts? What's wrong with walnuts or almonds or cashew nuts? I'm pretty sure it was some cousin of the finance minister's neighbor who was dealing in cashew nut. Otherwise, it's completely bizarre. So therefore, what happens with the Indian budget is this, that the budget, more than being an annual financial statement that the constitution says it is actually an announcement of tax policy. And therefore, you want to keep it very secret. And that is why it has this impact on certain things like the stock market. And you're right, we were sitting there, the stock market kept falling. Some of us were very happy that the stock market was falling. And then it suddenly started climbing up for no reason that we could think of. Anyway, so what happens in a typical budget exercise is, apart from this surprise thing, this year, what were we looking at? The biggest headline, as far as I was concerned, the most important thing that this budget delivered was fiscal discipline. Now, here is something that I want you to think about. Again, taking a cue from what Shamika said, don't listen to us, think about these issues. And what's this big deal about fiscal deficit? So what if fiscal deficit exceeds 3.9% of the GDP? Should we stick to this some thumb rule that has come without too much science into it. Believe me, there is it's a belief that if you are at this stage of development, then you should have a fiscal deficit less than 3.5% next year. Why? And so therefore you would find that the finance minister was advised by half of us saying don't stick to fiscal discipline, spend, because that is what will produce public expenditure. So the other half said no, stick to the discipline, and therefore when he stuck to it, the stock market went up. So that's the first question I'm leaving you with, that should India at the stage of development at which we are stick to a fiscal deficit target, or can we be flexible on that issue? The second issue that I was looking for, which so here full marks to the finance ministry, that some of us who believed that we should have some fiscal discipline felt very happy that despite huge pressure the finance minister stuck to his guns. The second issue, and again I am asking you this question and telling you to think about this, is, you know, what in your opinion is a big problem or a big challenge that the finance minister was facing this year? The big challenge he was facing this year was this whole banking story. And the banks are in a mess. We know that. Why are they in a mess? One reason you know they are in a mess is because Vijay Mallya runs away, right? So everybody knows that there is some problem with the bank. What we know is that, you know, banks are falling short of about 5 lakh crores of money. I mean, they're not going to find these 5 lakh crores. That's a lot of money. So how are we going to recover this? Should we be doing something about this? How important is banking to the Indian economy? You know, if you look at India's economy, banking seems to have a slightly higher importance, criticality to the economy than in other economies. And therefore, should we be extra sensitive about regulating our banks? What does the government do? One, it gives about 25,000 crore rupees to manage these NPAs. Would that be enough for something like 5 lakh crores? Is 25,000 crores enough? Is that enough to even help out one bank? We did that last year and we found that that much money was just enough to cover quarterly losses of two banks. So was that enough? Was that a smart thing to do? Of putting aside 25,000 crore rupees. The third point, that if you have such a huge problem of these rich guys borrowing money, running bankrupt airlines, IPL teams and calendars, should we do something about tackling these fellows? And one of the policy issues there is this entire problem that we have in India of bankruptcy. Why do you think that we don't have an option of bankruptcy in the country? Why is this one reform talked about, at least since I have been discussing this, I have spoken about this from 92 onwards, right? That we need a bankruptcy code this year. Every finance minister has promised it this year. And it's like 30 years now. So why don't we have one? We have huge number of Sikh units, huge number, millions of them. And why is it that the first thing that Arun Jaitley promised, unable to do in three budgets? Think on that issue also. I'm not giving you an answer to that. But that was one more thing that we expected would happen, never happened. The fourth issue, which I will borrow, is this issue of crop insurance. One more reason for crop insurance not working, one more problem that you face when you look at farmers in India is that what do you think is the farmer's biggest threat? One clearly is weather, right? Every fifth year, the farmer sees a drought. It's very unlikely when she sees two together. But every fifth year, so it's very high uncertainty, very high risk. But you know the bigger problem that farmers face in the country? Is price. It is price stability that is the problem. It's, you know, weather is one huge issue, but the big thing that hits them badly is price stability. We have a pittance of an allotment on what is called the price stabilization fund, but nobody knows how to work that fund. Just as we've done very little work on weather and derivatives and so on, we've done very little work on price and price stability. That was another thing that we thought should be attempted and wanted some action around it, didn't see much. And that became a serious problem. The other big headline was that last year, I remember very well, the Prime Minister getting up in the Parliament and saying, this is the beauty of India's Indian policy making. The Prime Minister got up and said that this scheme, this Rural Employment Guarantee Program, is a monumental failure of the Congress Party. And then he went on to say something even more bizarre. He said, we will continue it just to show how wrong they were. And this year, it's a drastic turnaround. It's a complete U-turn. And the Rural Development Ministry said that this is the best scheme ever put forward for rural development. And then we give what the finance minister wrongly said was the highest outlay. The highest outlay was Pranab Mukherjee's 2011 budget. But then this huge amount of money that was given to NREJ. The confusion is, the policy confusion is, so where do we stand on it? Are we saying that it's a failure? Are we saying it's a good thing? That became some kind of a question mark as far as the NREJ was concerned.
My question is, from last few years, there has been a trend of relaxations in FDI in many sectors, including insurance, etc. So my concern is that Indian stock markets as well as economy is turning increasingly vulnerable to global fluctuations. It is like we swim when they swim and we sink when they sink. So is this a necessary evil for emerging economies that we need to be dependent on foreign investment to pump our growth? Or can't there be any win-win situation that we can be insulated and grow as well?
You know, this closed economy view of things is basically, the way you have to think about it is that if there is no FDI in a particular sector, for instance, let's talk about retail, right? We are all, it's very close to us. We all go and buy things. We like malls. Now, if FDI in retail doesn't happen, who are we exactly benefiting by that? Who are these domestic firms that we are so proud of and we want to encourage? Do you think it will be easy for you to set up a retail chain? Or for me, or for Amir for that matter? It's again, you're saying 20 firms. Now, I want to wake you guys up to one rude reality. There are very few Indian firms that have actually withstood global competition. How many Indian brands? How many of you buy Tata cars, by the way? Who owns a Tata car? Ek aap hai. Bahut kam log hai, kyun? Why don't you buy Indian cars? If we want to make, we want to keep out foreign competition, and you shouldn't think of FDI as just funds. It's competition. Eventually, we want to open up a sector to competition. We prefer better products. Eventually, you know who gains by competition? Consumers. That's the idea of a liberal market. A liberal market. And at the end, of course, we want to protect. I mean, eventually, if that marginal decision has to be made, and this is an American firm and this is an Indian firm, and I say, yeah, you unnis bees, and we'll go ahead with him after all, when he earns money, the hope is it gets spent in India. So there is an economic rationale for why I must protect. That's the Swadeshi view of things. Not that he's selling a substandard product, he's got a world-class product, I'll still go with this guy, kyun bhai? Why should I force all of you to buy Tata IndyCars? You should think about FDI in that form, not some abstract issue.